Over the weekend, myself and the rest of the Washington, D.C. Area Film Critics Association had the tough job of voting on the best in different categories of 2014 films. Stepping back and looking at it all, the films that were released, I definitely believe we had a great year. Today, I have a couple of familiar faces on the show, fellow WAFCA critics Michael Parsons of DCFilmdom.com and Hamilton Whitney of FilmHamster.com are stopping by the studio so that we can talk about and review some of the films that came out this year. That's all ahead on Picture Lock. Twenty 2014 was another great year in film. Today I'm going to talk with Michael Parsons of DCFilmdom.com and Hamilton Whitney of FilmHamster.com about some of the films that have come out this year. Now, I do plan to have a roundup episode, but we'll hash out some of the more interesting and talked about films that came out this year. Michael and Hamilton, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you.
It's my pleasure, guys. I love doing this. And this is one of my favorite episodes. We're back to the old school circular table, getting down and dirty and talking about film in my Bill Cosby voice. Although Bill Cosby might not be a good reference right now. Okay. All right. So the first thing we're going to go into is not one of the more meaty films. This is just one of the all the teeny boppers, you know, love this. Hunger Games Mockingjay Part 1. So following her rescue from the devastating Quarter Quell, Katniss awakes in the complex beneath the supposedly destroyed District 13. Guys, what do you all think about just the overall thoughts of Mockingjay Part 1? We'll start with the film hamster himself, because you have a special tie to the
whole. Yes, I do.
Go ahead.
As I've mentioned to you before, I'm a big fan of the franchise. Before it was even a movie, got involved actually with a Hunger Games fan site, so I sort of have a little bit of, feel like I have a vested interest in how these films do. Most fans will agree that the third book is not the best book. It's the weakest of the trilogy, so it was interesting to see how that would translate to film. I thought it was actually the worst film of the series so far, but wow. was still pretty decent. It was a great adaptation. It mostly failed because it followed true to the book and it was guilty of some of the same faults.
Yeah, what did you think?
Well, I'm sort of from the opposite end of the spectrum because I hadn't read any of those, you know, books by Suzanne Collins, and but so the series kind of grew on me. You know, the first one I liked, Catching Fire, the best. This film, like Hamilton said, was definitely the weakest, and I think it's just that it suffers from the dividing up the final book into two parts syndrome. You know, it kind of struggles to fill the 2 hours. I don't think it's any fault of the director or the cinematographer. I just think it was a really spread thin script.
Right.
You know, it was a lot different, not as much action.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I'd agree. I think, you know, it definitely sets up part two for an awesome, you know, final battle. But as one reviewer put it, you know, it was an awesome extended trailer for part two.
Right.
You know, like, it's like, oh, okay, well, I guess we'll have to wait for part two now. But I still thought that I was actually pretty surprised at how suspenseful it was. It, you know, played out a lot more like a political thriller than, you know, as it has been this kind of cool action film. But we can kind of get into that in terms of the direction from Francis Lawrence. So obviously he did Catching Fire, and now, you know, he's doing this one. And so he's kind of crafted this new kind of tone for I guess, part one, and we'll see how part two goes. But, you know, in terms of the new direction, what do you guys think about that?
You want to roll with this one?
Sure. I think it's going in a good direction. He really did capture the behind the scenes of the political goings on. It's not quite as obvious in the movies so far as the books, but there's a lot going on behind the scenes with manipulation on both sides. Both people, we've got President Coyne of District 13 and President Snow of the Evil Capital, and both have their agendas, definitely. Mm-hmm. And it's really setting up the political aspects to see some of how that manipulation happens, that the war itself is like the games, even though it's not the games.
Yeah, definitely.
Mind games.
Michael. Yeah, like it definitely opened up to this broader scope, even though it kind of felt a little claustrophobic, just because a lot of the time is spent indoors, and it's this darker, kind of more realistic film as far as, you know, the oppression of the government, and it's really kind of overflowed into the whole society, and everybody sort of feeling the effects of it. I thought that was interesting, and like you guys said, I thought that, you know, this is opening it up to, you know, a huge ending. But, you know, again, was it necessary to have a lead up that was 2 hours long? But I did like aspects of it, and I thought technically it was well done. And it was relatively engaging, just not as good as Catching Fire.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And I felt like, as you said, it's kind of like, you know, if they made the final film 3 hours rather than like splitting it up into like, I guess it's going to be like something like 4 hours now. Mm-hmm. Like, I could have sat through that and I would have really enjoyed it. But I do think that, you know, the direction, there's obviously, you can feel the director's hand behind it. And by that, I mean, like, you know, from the opening with Katniss, you can just tell like she's in a new, different place. Mentally, and I guess I don't read the books. I just watch the movie. But I guess that comes across in the book. And mm-hmm. So I felt that. I felt the weight of each character, you know, as we moved forward. And so we can kind of get into the performances. We have Jennifer Lawrence, Josh Hutcherson, Liam Hemsworth, Woody Harrelson, Donald Sutherland, Philip Seymour Hoffman in his final performance, and Julianne Moore. So this is like a really good ensemble, actually. And I felt as though the performances, except maybe Julianne Moore as the president, I wasn't feeling that too much. However, I felt like overall everyone is like in the zone in terms of their characters. What do you think, Mike?
Yeah, I thought the acting, I thought everybody was pretty spot on with their fulfilling their roles, literally and in the film, their characters fulfilling the roles, the various roles that, you know, they were sort of have been building up over the last two films. You know, Woody Harrelson has a smaller part, but he's great. You know, he's like kind of sobering up and this other part of his character is coming out. I agree with Julianne Moore, you know, she's such a terrific actor that you didn't really see a whole lot of depth there, but, you know, I mean, I didn't really see anybody else doing it any better than she did. And of course, Jennifer Lawrence was terrific. You know, you can see her character really evolving in Jennifer Lawrence. And so I think, she did a really good job there.
Yeah.
I agree. I think a lot of the supporting characters were a bit underutilized, which was, to go back, one of the faults, I think, of the book coming from strictly Katniss's point of view, and we're stuck in her head so much of the time that it becomes very claustrophobic, literally, as well as figuratively. Mm. And it didn't quite, I was hoping there would be more character development in the film to escape from that a little bit more and delve into the other characters. But I mean, everybody did a fantastic job. I think they just were underutilized, and it's a little hard to fault putting Jennifer Lawrence on the screen, though.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like Hamilton is like the resident expert on this. So I'll just throw it out at Hamilton. Yeah. I do agree. You know, I think this has been a great series for her, though, you know, because, mm-hmm. And as we've talked about before, like, she's just a powerhouse actress. And so even though that, you know, with this, I guess you can say, I mean, personally for me, I'm a little bit tired of seeing her as Katniss Everdeen. I still believe that, like, in this film, it's the human aspect of her. It almost translates from like, Jennifer Lawrence herself, but it's that relatability mm-hmm. to Katniss that really helps you to enjoy and invest in her character. What were you going to say, Mike?
Well, yes, I agree. Because as sort of outlandish as the whole theme of the film and book series is, she is very believable, I think, as a person going through, you know, this situation, this unbelievable situation. She does make it believable and relatable, mm-hmm. You know, as she does in most of her roles.
Okay, cool. Any final thoughts, guys?
Other than, you know, being sad to see Philip Seymour Hoffman in his last role. He's such a great actor.
Tell me about it.
Well, he will be in part two.
He will?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
They filmed them simultaneously.
Resident so. Expert.
He had completed all but like two or three scenes in which they sort of changed up the dialogue. And yeah. So he will be appearing in the second part.
That's cool.
Good to know.
we could get off subject with Philip Seymour Hoffman, maybe another episode. But yeah, all right, cool. So that's Mockingjay part one. All right, let's move on to Interstellar. Now, you know, I know, like most people, Interstellar was that film that I was waiting on, you know? So I was super excited about, am I?
I was sitting next to you at the screening. I know exactly how excited you were.
Exactly. So I was really excited. Okay, so the summary. In Earth's future, a global crop blight and second dust bowl are slowly rendering the planet uninhabitable. Professor Brand, a brilliant NASA physicist, is working on plans to save mankind by transporting Earth's population to a new home via a wormhole. But first, Brand must send former NASA pilot Cooper and a team of researchers through the wormhole and across the galaxy to find out which of the three planets could be mankind's new home. All right, so that's the summary of the whole thing. Christopher Nolan back in the director's chair. Now, I don't know about you guys, but Christopher Nolan is definitely one of my top 10, you know, directors working today. So I was really excited to see this film. And we can definitely get into, We can get into spoilers on this, because if you haven't seen Interstellar by now, then, you know, so spoiler alert. But I gotta say, like, I'll give him the compliment first. I thought it was awesome in terms of he swung for the fences, right? Mm-hmm. Now, it might have fallen a little short and somebody caught it, like, right? But he swung for the fences, and it's obvious, like, just in his storytelling. And, I mean, this is, you're starting to see this, like, in all the films that he's making. He's not just going for, you know, the popcorn, you know, entertainment. He's going for a cinematic experience. And I definitely felt that, once again, as a director, he had a clear vision for what he wanted. And he pushed cinema in ways that, like, it needs, you know? Cinema is only but so old. And so we need the Christopher Nolans to push things forward. Michael, you look like you are itching to say something. Go ahead.
No, I agree. Christopher Nolan is one of my favorite directors. Absolutely. He is so influential on, you know, cinema in the last, you know, of the new millennium, like, you know, starting with Memento, going through all the Batman series. My favorite film of his is Inception, probably. I felt like you said he swung for the fences. He takes these extremely elaborate concepts, which is commendable, particularly in blockbuster films that typically are just, like you said, popcorn movies. But it went a little bit, I think it was a little too big for its britches. To me, a lot of it was similar visually to bits of Inception. I felt like it was sort of treading similar ground. And I thought it was funny that it, like you said, it fell a little short because it was, to me, about a half hour too long, right. Which probably a lot of people agree with. But it, you know, visually it was spectacular. I don't want to cover the whole thing right now, but, you know, those were my general thoughts. But even a subpar Christopher Nolan movie is still better than a typical film in my book.
Right. You know? And the, you know, the interesting thing is that a lot of times, or some people, you know, the internet trolls say, you know, oh, you know, Christopher Nolan, he's not that great. He's an overrated director. And saying that a lot of times it's because he actually technically is an astute director, right? So when he makes a film, it's going to be technically well done versus most of the films that come out that year. But a lot of people feel like there's still those different holes in it, etc. And kind of like you said, kind of we're seeing a little bit of recycling in terms of Inception. But I don't know. I personally, I'm not in that boat. I think he actually does make great films. And I think that, you know, the way that he pushed things forward with this film, especially trying to use more practical versus CG.
Yeah,
that
for sure.
That was amazing, and it really helped you to get into it. Hamilton, what did you think?
I really enjoyed it. I'd actually have to disagree and say it could have gone a half hour longer, and I was not bored. I could have. I mean, if we want to get into the ending a little bit,
let's.
But as he leaves to to search for, her name's escaping me, but. The one they left behind.
Yeah. Anne Hathaway.
Well, I was looking for the character. But as he's looking for Anne Hathaway, I would have been interested to see what happened there. I wasn't upset that it ended there, but it could have gone for longer, in my opinion, and I wouldn't have been upset. But it was a little bit before then that it lost me with the whole bookcase. It sort of felt like it got into a little bit silly, cliche, Twilight Zone-y.
Right.
Because everything else seemed so thought out. For the most part, there was a lot of at least semi-real science, which is beyond me, so I'm not sure how much of it was real or theoretical or made up, but it felt real at least. And then at that point, it just sort of felt off.
Yeah.
But overall, I really enjoyed it.
Definitely.
I think probably, I may be speaking out of turn here, but probably where I got, and I don't want to just spoil everything, but where I got kind of, not lost with it, but where it went a little off track was when the characters got into a fist fight on that frozen planet.
Mm.
And that, to me, almost felt like a little contrived for a Nolan film, you know.
Mm.
But again, I wasn't bored during the film. I mean, to me, you know, I am comparing this to other Nolan films, which almost isn't fair to Christopher Nolan. Because, you know, you're walking in with this, you know, these incredible expectations because he just constantly just upends the, you know, whatever genre. I don't even know if you can really classify it.
Right.
You know, if this movie had just come out of the blue, never heard of it, I'd probably be still bowled over by it. So it might be unfair in that regard, but, you know.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, that scene with Matt Damon and everything, like, I will say that there were some breadcrumbs that, you know, but at the end of the day, like, the thing that I loved about it was the stakes were so huge. And we're going to talk a little bit about the performances, but with Matthew McConaughey and, you know, it really hinged on him and his daughter. And as, you know, Michael was sitting next to me and hopefully you didn't see me crying because, you know, I'm a man, I don't cry. But I was crying.
There was that scene.
Dude, it was intense. And, like, the fact that, you know, the stakes are so high. If we go down on this planet, the gravity is, you know, a lot higher than, you know, so, like, just a few seconds
it's
means.
7 years.
Yeah, exactly. So, like, to me, I was really invested. Like, you got to get back to your daughter. You got to. But I think. So that part with Matt Damon, like, I got into it because it's like, no, like, you know, kick his butt, you know, get up, get back to the ship, whatever. Like, we just wasted time on a planet. Let's go to the next one. But I think what Hamilton said, and you're sitting next to me, I literally groaned out loud when, you know, I was just like, no, don't. I don't want to spoil this, so I won't do that. But I was like, don't go into the wormhole. But I'm like, okay, this movie has been so emotional that him not making it home is okay. Like, that's okay. That's all right. And I was willing to let him go. I was willing to, you know.
Yeah.
But it just so happened that suddenly he was in a bookshelf. And I'm like, what? And so that's what I'm talking about. Like, it's like, it's up. And then suddenly somebody just came out of the sky and caught it.
Yeah. And it seemed to not get, it didn't really show its work there, as far as I was concerned, which was the thing that irritated me a little bit. Now, you know, of course, I'm not going into this questioning the science. That would be ridiculous.
right.
Plus, I wouldn't know what I was talking about anyway. But that part seemed a little too, I don't know, like they were enthralled too much with the concept and they just didn't know when to stop, like this endless
what
kind
to
of,
do with the concept.
Yeah, where to go with it. And but, you know, again, and then he ends up, you know, I don't know if I want to go as far as to explain what happens after that, but where he ends up after that didn't really get explained. And but I will say that the scene where McConaughey is watching the video from his Jessica Chastain.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can speak for you, Eddie, out there, but I was welling up a little. I'm sure he was, too, because he has two daughters. So,
right.
You know.
Yeah, definitely. And I was, because, and that's the thing. Like, the performance was just amazing. And Matthew McConaughey right now, like, who'd have thought that, like, the rom-com guy.
Nobody.
Right, exactly, would turn into this stellar.
He's had the best year of his career.
But, exactly. I mean,
so well, a couple years.
Yeah. Between Mudd and True Detective and all those.
Definitely.
You know, Dallas Buyers Club
Dallas
last
Buyers
year.
Club, incredible.
Yeah. Yeah, so, I mean, it was just amazing. Mackenzie Foy is, his daughter. And Jessica Chastain is the older version. I mean, I just thought that was amazing. Hans Zimmer, he's hands down one of my, favorite composers in the industry. And I felt like the score just supplemented the film so well. And the Christopher Nolan Hans Zimmer team up, like, you're mm-hmm. gonna get, like, it's gonna be
intensity.
Stellar. Exactly.
Full on intensity. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
You know what you're in for, but that's a good thing.
Right.
Yeah, that was a very intense score, I guess, for sure.
It was like the pipe organs. It was purposefully kind of, it was almost like nails scratching on a board, like it just got
it
you.
It never let up, actually, for a good portion of film. It was like somebody just laid on the synth, and.
Right.
But yeah, he is one of the best composers out there.
All right, cool. So overall, guys, what'd you think of Interstellar?
I would like to go see it again on a true 70mm IMAX. Mm. Even though it wasn't my favorite of Nolan's, I think it's worth a look on a true, not a digital, but a true, like at the Smithsonian, I would like to go see it.
Mm-hmm. I can't imagine seeing that wave and some of those space vistas.
Yes, yeah. That wave was incredible.
Yeah, that was an intense scene.
Yeah, it's definitely a movie worth checking out.
Yeah, definitely. All right, so let's move forward to Alejandro González Iñárritu's Birdman. Now, this is going to be one of those films that, definitely right now as we're kind of in gearing up to award season, people are going to talk about a lot. And I think it should be talked about a lot. It's about the former superhero played by Michael Keaton, who used to be Birdman, who in real life used to be Batman, and like this whole metaphor thing that's going on. It's a little trippy, but at the same time, like, you can really follow the story. And I personally think that Alejandro, as the director, he needs to get a lot more praise because, as a director to have this vision and to execute it, in such a great way, I think that that's why the film is so great. Granted, the performances are excellent, which we can get into. But I definitely think that the direction is there. And as you guys know, just these long takes with the seamless, you can't really tell that it's edited because, they go into the dark or whatever the case may be. But I just thought it was genius. And I've never seen it where in a long take, we push forward in time. Yeah. And there's, you know what happened. You understand that, okay, time has moved forward. But it all felt seamless. Yeah. What did you guys think?
Well, like you said, with the cinematography, the whole thing, or 90% of it, I guess, takes place in this theater, like the St. James Theater on Broadway. I don't know if they actually filmed the entire thing in there. But, Emmanuel Lubezki, who did the cinematography, I guess, for Gravity is the guy that did this. And the same idea, like he did in that film, with these long sort of takes where there's no break. And I guess the movie, the most astounding thing to me was that, the illusion of one long take, like you said, where there are time lapses and like using different devices and hallways and doorways to sort of lapse that time or looping around a room. And then you just get the sense, oh, it's like an hour later. And, as they're preparing for this big play and
right.
And then, of course, the performances are phenomenal. I thought all around, in every category, this film sort of encompassed the strongest of each. The technical, the acting, directing, script was all phenomenal. I love
yeah.
it. I love that movie.
Definitely. Hamilton.
Yeah. Conceptually, I thought it was really great. I wasn't the biggest fan of it overall.
I love Hamilton. Maybe he always comes in with like, it was great,
the
but yeah, exactly. That's awesome.
As a movie, it wasn't one of my favorites, but the cinematography, the concept, just the way that it was done was amazing and absolutely worth seeing,
right.
only for that reason. The whole sort of existential theater world, maybe I'd have to be in that world to really get it, the stage. But it's definitely unique.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Now, see, you might not know this, but in high school, I was a thespian. So
So, I believe it. Absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. I could kind of see. No, honestly, I don't know what they do on Broadway, but I love the fact that because of the long takes, there was pressure in real life on the actors to get it right, while their characters on screen have the pressure to get it right as well. So that both of them coming together, I kind of felt like, yeah, maybe this is what it's like behind, you know, the screen on Broadway. And that's kind of the things that I love, because they had their, you know, if you want to call it incestuous drama that was happening amongst the cast, mm-hmm. right? And it would be like, they put on the show, they turn on, and then as soon as the curtain comes down, it's back to that drama, you know? Yeah. So I really felt like that was cool, and that's what kind of drew me into the ensemble, because, you know, you just kept kind of riding with them, and like, the this is me behind the curtain, you know? Like, it's not like what we would usually see, which is sitting in the audience, wow, that was such a great performance. But instead, it's like, that was a great performance. Oh, gosh, there's actually...
Everybody's really crazy.
Yeah, exactly. But let's talk about some of these performances. You got Michael Keaton, Emma Stone, Edward Norton, Zach Galifianakis, Naomi Watts. I felt like everybody just really brought it in this film. Emma Stone just made me feel like, why are you doing like The Amazing Spider-Man? Like, you need to keep doing films like this, because like, she really did do a great job. But enough of me, you guys. Hamilton, what did you think of performances?
They were all spot on, really. Like you were saying, both their on-stage performance as well as their film performance, there was a distinction, and it just really, really worked. They were all unique characters. It wasn't confusing, mm-hmm. which I attribute a lot to the performances of the actors, because it could be a very confusing film.
Right.
And everybody kept very consistent while being entertaining.
Yeah.
Yeah, I felt, you know, like the entire film kind of had a split personality, yeah. all the characters. With the exception of Emma Stone, because her character was not on stage for anything, and you know, she's sort of struggling to reconcile with her dad, who's going through this crisis. I think Michael Keaton's, I can't think of a performance of his that moved me as much as that. And mm-hmm. just like you said, the parallel to his real career, like they even mm-hmm. lined up the timeline with his, like, you know, his big Birdman career was like 92, which is when Keaton did his last Batman movie.
Yeah, right.
So there was something very personal about it to Keaton too, which probably drove a lot of the performance. But yeah, I mean, certainly Keaton, like you said, Hamilton, everybody was spot on, Edward Norton's performance was amazing.
Right.
Even Galifianakis playing mm-hmm. completely against type as the voice of reason. Galifianakis is the voice of reason.
Right.
If you've seen any Hangover movie or any other movie he's been in, that's not what, you know, would come to mind when you think of Galifianakis.
Right.
I just thought the movie was full of surprises, and the, you know, performances just brought it home totally.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Like you said, I just loved Edward Norton and his character. He just seemed like a jerk. Like, it felt believable. Like, this is what a Broadway ego looks like, you know? but then at the same time, it was funny because, like, they don't take themselves too seriously. Like, him, you know, getting the tanning and then having, like, a fight, you know? Like,
yeah, right. I forgot about that part.
That was pretty awesome. But, you know, one of the things that, you know, I did kind of enjoy is... just seeing, like, we're in Keaton's head, right? Or Birdman is in his head, so therefore, like, we're kind of there too. And there's this question of, like, what's real and what's mm-hmm. not. So from the beginning, like, he's floating in air. And so it's kind of like, okay, this is going to be different. But then, like, suddenly, like, the regular rules of the world apply to everything. But then, like, again, like, he'll be able to go like this and break a lamp. And then, like, suddenly when someone comes into the room, it's like, oh, he just knocked everything over.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I love the kind of playing with reality that was done in the film as well.
Yeah. And it's never quite resolved either.
Right.
With the ending there.
Yeah. And that's great because it's like, it doesn't necessarily have to. It's kind of like Under the Skin in the sense of some things, you're just like, the whole time you're just like, what is going on? Like, And I think in film, sometimes not everything has to be explained. And that, maybe going back to Interstellar, is what I think kind of messed Interstellar up, that everything had to be explained.
Right.
But sometimes, like, we're smart enough as an audience and as, you know, viewers to say, okay, I'll go with it,
right.
you know?
Without feeling like it's a cop-out. Like, they've built up this story that they can't, you know, they're writing a check
justify.
They can't cash.
Yeah.
Right.
And they're just like, well, you know, like the end of The Sopranos.
Yeah, definitely. All right, so, you know, just in terms of technically, you did kind of hit that, but the cinematography, you definitely have to throw that into the awards, you know,
definitely.
Circle, because to be able to do these long takes, which they go from one room to another, and the lighting scheme doesn't change, or I'd say it changes, but obviously everything looks great.
We don't notice it changes,
you
right?
don't notice. Everyone was in focus. Focus puller, everybody is working together. This film technically, you know, is just like a marvel to watch. And, you know, as a filmmaker myself, I understand that, like, what really went into making that happen. It just doesn't happen like that. You know what I mean? Like, they didn't just say, okay, today we're going to shoot this long take. Like, that's a lot of pre-production, a lot of planning. And like I said, like, for the cinematography to be that on point, it's amazing, incredible.
Yeah.
Any geek out thoughts on the technicality of the film?
Well, I think the big thing was the cinematography, like we talked about, just that using, you know, people a lot of the times equate great cinematography with this expansive, like, panoramic stuff, you know, like vistas, and I think it's just as hard in narrow spaces and, you know, like you said, moving around rooms and having everything in focus and the lighting and everything like that. So I thought that was phenomenal.
Yeah, definitely. Final thoughts.
I'd have to mention the CG, because you don't see it. But you know there has to be a lot of CG there with the editing and with the hidden stops between the take to make everything seamless. That it's one of those instances where people complain about CG when it's so obvious and then don't realize when it's doing a really good job to get that final product.
I would have to... I wish I had a fact checker, because I have a feeling that like most of those stops could have been done without any CG. I mean, there was some.
I feel like I read an article about it. I don't remember where, so I can't back that up. But I know there was a lot of behind the scenes with the editing and computer generated. But
yeah.
Okay. An hour just on Birdman.
Yeah, I know, right? But we can't. So let's move on to Foxcatcher. All right, so wrestler Mark Schultz forms a relationship with his new sponsor, millionaire John DuPont, as they train for the 1988 Games in Seoul, a union that leads to unlikely circumstances as both men feel inferior to Mark's revered brother Dave. Now, this stars Channing Tatum, Steve Carell, and Mark Ruffalo. I gotta say, like, I really enjoyed Foxcatcher. I feel as though, in some ways, some people, including myself, you know, I don't know, it could have been a little bit better. It felt like the tone of it, really the makeup and prosthetics of it. I feel like the performances, Mark Ruffalo was the best performance out of the film. That's all I'm going to say right now. But I want to hear what you guys got to say, and then I'm going to argue this. But I think Mark Ruffalo is the best performance. What did you guys think about the film?
Well, the one thing that I agree with you on is Ruffalo's performance. Mm-hmm. I thought his was the most relatable, emotionally challenging role. Not that Carell and Tatum didn't obviously really slip into these roles of these two kind of very severe people that are, you know, that don't express a lot of emotion, but Ruffalo stood out to me.
Right.
While the rest of the film to me felt very, very, very cold and kind of like being in a museum. If that makes any sense.
It does. It does. Hamilton.
I think the only thing I'll agree with you on is that Mark Ruffalo was the best performance out of the cast there.
Right.
The whole movie felt rather pointless to me.
Uh-huh.
Without giving away too much, with the incident that happens near the end, reading the synopsis, I assumed that the film would take place with that near the beginning and examine what happened because of it.
Right.
But instead, we sort of get a mediocre wrestling sports story with no real plot or point until like the last 15 minutes, and it just didn't work for me.
Yeah, yeah. Now, I feel like I felt like it was an exercise in tone. And so Bennett Miller was the director. And I feel like in regards to tone, like he definitely had a tone for the film throughout. And it just felt like, I think part of the reason that anyone could be turned off to it is because it just felt awkward. Like John DuPont was just an awkward guy. And Steve Carell is really able to, as we said, like that's kind of against type. Now, if you've watched his career, you know that he has it in him to do a role like this. The awkwardness and insecurities really pervade throughout the whole entire film. And so I feel as though because of the tone of the film, it does feel kind of like you're watching and you don't want to watch because it's, I don't know. I mean, even with the whole wrestling thing, it just had like this weird homoerotic tone to it that instead of like, it didn't delve into it, it just kind of like touches it and like, you know, and it's so, it's kind of like, well, what exactly are we, you know, like,
it's a very bizarre relationship that they developed, yeah.
And so it's kind of like, I think that's kind of what in some ways can turn you off to the film in general, because it does feel like I'm saying, it's just very awkward. It's just like kind of weird. But, you know, Mark Ruffalo is like the one guy that you can turn to like, okay, what's really happening in this film? And he'll kind of like bring everybody back together. Does what anything that I just say make any sense at all?
Yes, it makes sense. It makes sense that you would at least argue that.
Right.
But, and before I go, I forgot to mention that, yeah, some of those wrestling maneuvers, particularly with Tatum, are pretty phenomenal. I mean, very, you know, impressive acrobatics. Of course, he comes from a background of athletics and dance and stuff like that. But back to Carell and that, the relationship. It was an odd relationship. They did a really good job of making it feel very uncomfortable and awkward, and you weren't really sure what was going on with Carell. He did a good job of making you kind of squirm. You're wondering what his intentions are. Is he unstable? Is he calculating? You know, what's going on? But to me, it never really developed beyond that. I felt like the ugliness of it just sort of wore thin. And Hamilton made a really good point. Since it's based on a true story, a lot of people know the ending and what happened. So it would have been interesting. You know, you're building up to this tragic moment. If they had sort of started with that and then maybe shown what happened after or gotten a little bit into some aspects of it that, you know, the general public wasn't aware of already. But I just felt like it didn't really, I felt like it was told with very little energy and charisma.
Mm-hmm.
From a technical standpoint, I thought it was very good. Good direction, good cinematography, good score. If I just covered the whole thing.
Yeah. No, I mean, I totally agree. I go ahead, Hamilton.
I was just pretty much agreeing. That's,
Sorry, you know, I used up a long trip.
No, it's quite all right. You know, it's kind of funny because it's like, in talking about Foxcatcher, it's almost the same awkwardness of watching Foxcatcher. Like, it's like, you're trying to put your finger on it. But again, it just, I'm sorry, like, Mark Ruffalo was the best thing to come out of you know, the film, so.
Yeah, and, you know, they're all good actors. I mean, were there any other aspects that came out that you thought were, I felt just.
Well, there's the prosthetics, if we wanted to sort of touch on that, which I found kind of a little odd. I'm not quite sure the
actually, like,
purpose by it.
or quite the purpose behind.
I watched the film, and then I went to the internet and I looked up like John DuPont on Wikipedia, and literally I looked at the picture and I said, why do they have Steve Carell? Like, who like was playing a game and like put Steve Carell right there? But then I looked harder and I was like, oh no, that's really the guy. So in terms of makeup and the prosthetics, like it was spot on, definitely for John DuPont's character. You know, I thought it was kind of interesting with Tatum because, you know, it was definitely an internal performance with him, but it kind of, I felt like for Tatum's character and Carell's, there was a lot, it felt like Sling Blade. That's what kept coming to my mind. Like, I don't know if you guys seen that film, but like it was just kind of like these guys are a little off mentally. And so I don't know. But yeah, the prosthetics was on point in terms of, you know, Carell looking like John DuPont.
But nobody knows. The general public doesn't know what John DuPont looks like.
That's
so I don't feel like it was really necessary. It seemed more distracting than anything.
That's true.
Like they were playing dress up.
Though, by the same token, I can't really think of anybody that would have done any better with the material and the way that DuPont was supposed to be, if that makes any sense. Like, you know, the script is calling for him to act a certain way and mm-hmm. be a certain way and be very dry. And I think Carell did as well as anybody could. I don't imagine anything, you know, anybody doing any better with that material.
I don't disagree.
But yeah. but that's not necessarily a positive. It's just, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can make a technically magnificent movie of paint drying, but it isn't
right.
worth watching.
Right. Agreed.
Ouch.
Yeah. Not that Foxcatcher's as bad as just watching paint dry.
Right.
I didn't really find it had a point.
You were ready for it to be over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I will say that I did. Like going into seeing the film, I was thinking that this is gonna be like just an awesome movie. I didn't feel that way. I think that's understood amongst us all. And as I was watching it, you know, like trying to knock out all these screeners, it was one of those screeners that I was just like, dog, I could have probably knocked out a different film, you know?
Or two.
Yeah, right. Within this time.
Yeah,
so yeah, all right. Well, so obviously Foxcatcher, we enjoyed Ruffalo's performance. Because honestly, like, I didn't even realize. Like, I knew Tatum and Carell was in it, but I didn't know who the third guy was. And I think that's mainly because, like, anyways, I'm going to stop blowing him up. Yeah.
He's great. Why not?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, he's typically a highlight of any movie he's in. And he, you know, he's just a great actor.
True. All right. So let's go into our last film, which is Richard Linklater's Boyhood. Now, when it comes to, you know, the awards and all that good stuff for this year, I have to think that Boyhood is going to, you know, be getting some top honors. Mm-hmm. But I know why I think that, but why do you guys think that if you do? We'll start with you, Hamilton.
Well, obviously, the just uniqueness of it, the way that Linklater filmed this same story over the period of its 12 years, I believe, the same cast, the same story, this about the, you know, the boy from when he was 8 to 18 or somewhere, or 6 to 18.
Somewhere, yeah, that's right.
12 years, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that just that alone is enough to get some attention. And then he does pull it off. It wasn't my favorite movie, mm-hmm. but it was extraordinarily well done to keep a running theme and a running story over such a long period of time in the film's timeline, as well as filming it over 12 years.
Yeah.
It's just pretty extraordinary.
Yeah.
I think I'm in the same place about it that Hamilton is. You know, it as an undertaking, you can't not be in awe by a 12-year endeavor where you're using the same, you know, first off, a kid who was not an actor, who was six when it started, and then you have Patricia Arquette and Ethan Hawke who are filming, you know, how many movies during a 12-year period, but still coming revisiting this, I guess, once a year or every couple years to film a couple scenes. I thought as an undertaking it was phenomenal. I thought the movie was fine. I thought the acting, particularly Patricia Arquette, was very moving. It had its standout moments. And it was, you know, mainly interesting to see a kid literally grow up on screen, like you said.
Yeah. You know, I think this is like, you know, up there as one of the best of the year. And I'm going to say the reason being is because I feel like as a filmmaker, Linklater's vision to capture this, like every, you know, like whatever summer, you just take a week to film the new scene, to have, like, to write the script and to be able to, you know, stay on top of this over 12 years to see a concise story. like, the boy grows up. Like, I really felt like it was more of a documentary. The writing, it didn't feel like, okay, this was, like, scripted. This just felt like this is what a six-year-old, you know, would say. This is what a nine-year-old would say. And as the title is, Boyhood, like, as I was watching it, I was like, yeah, I remember that as a kid. I remember that as a kid. And the other part that was fascinating about it is that within each year, Linklater gives some kind of breadcrumb as to, like, what was going on, like, pop culture-wise at the time. And so, you know, whether it was, like, was it Pokemon that, like, in the beginning, like, the boy was playing with, or...
I think so.
Yeah, it's as things moved on, you know, like, it was just like, wow, like, this is not only kind of talking about one boy's life, you know, and you know, growing up into adolescence, but it's also kind of showing us what's happening in America at the same time. You look like you want to say something.
Well, the music was the thing, you know.
Right.
Music as well. Yeah, and so he was very specific about the music that he used in each transitional year. And it was kind of nostalgic, you know, and it had a certain feeling about it going through each of those, particularly in the, you know, obviously in his younger years when, you know, it was longer ago.
Right.
I thought that was, he really punctuated it with the music. It was really good.
Definitely.
Yeah. To go off of that, I did enjoy how he could have done something like Summer of 1998 or something, you know, underneath there.
Right.
There was no timeline specified. There were just a lot of clues given to sort of give you an idea of when this is now taking place.
Right.
Which was less distracting, I think, than showing, really chunking it up and, okay, we've started a new chapter.
Yeah.
Just sort of a little more seamless there.
But I truly feel like story-wise, like I said, I felt like we were watching a documentary and we just revisited this kid's life every time. But I loved how bringing in, like, the abusive stepfather and kind of, you know, as a child, there are certain things that you or issues that you see or you have to deal with, but you don't necessarily know exactly what it is. And I felt like he captured that in such a great way where it was like, we saw it as we would have seen it as a child. Like, we would have seen, you know, our mother on the floor, and then, you know, stepfather comes out and says, oh, she's had an accident or whatever, and then you keep going on about your business. But, you know, it still felt kind of like, oh, well, what happened to mom? And eventually we kind of see how, like, they're putting two and two together, and then even, like, feeling like, well, what's going to happen to our, you know, step-siblings or whatever. I just felt like that was just... I don't know. I just felt like it was true. It was real. It resonated with me in a way that I feel like in lesser hands it wouldn't have done. Mike.
Yeah, I feel like that portion of the film that you just described was the most. I don't want to overuse the word moving, but it definitely had the most impact as far as a traumatic event that's a believable traumatic event that might occur in a kid's life where, like you said, they don't necessarily understand, like, oh, well, my stepdad's an alcoholic. Like, you know, he's just angry. You know, what's going, you know, they don't really understand that. I can't remember how old he was at that part of the film, but he was still...
Fairly young.
Yeah, was he like under 10 still, or was he like around there?
I feel like it had to have been like around 10.
But that and Arquette's acting during that whole, you know, everything, like you said, felt pretty unscripted, like most of his films, like all before... Sunrise and Sunset and Midnight movies where that also covered a 20-year expanse of time just felt very much like a day in the life, and sometimes it was like a day in a not so good day in the life, you know, and sometimes it was better days, and I felt the same way about it.
I also think going back to the performances, Ethan Hawke and Patricia Arquette, they both did a great job of portraying the adult characters, and you can see them growing up. I think Ethan Hawke definitely, because he kind of went from like that, I'm the cool dad that comes in to like suddenly like, it's like, oh, he's got a new wife and he's got a kid. Like, and I love that, you know, we figure that out and we keep moving forward, but we also see him mature, you know what I mean? And so like, he's still got like the crazy zaniness to him, but like you see this maturation. Same thing with Patricia Arquette. I feel like, you know, like as true to real life, she did go through a couple of relationships that, you know, weren't so good. But I do think she also learned from that as well. And then it was just cool to see him, like, graduate from high school and whatnot. And, you know, it felt like, oh, my family. You know what I mean? Like, the family's getting together to celebrate. Like, his sister comes back and stuff like that. So I just felt like that was just awesome.
Yeah, I guess the kid's name is Eller Coltrane. That's mm-hmm. So that was, I mean, for a kid to take that on is pretty amazing.
Right.
Yeah, to commit to that.
And amazingly, he actually, by the end of the film, had a pretty striking resemblance to Ethan Hawke, I thought. Which was convenient.
Right. Yeah. Maybe there's something we don't know.
Yeah, right. I'll have to go back and see if that's true. That's kind of interesting.
But he also kind of developed as an actor along the way, too, which was the thing, because he went from not, you know, obviously a six-year-old in his first movie to being kind of an actor, but still not feeling like one. So that was interesting.
Yeah, definitely. All right, so final thoughts on Boyhood.
Astounding undertaking. And, overall, a film I think most people will enjoy and appreciate and be moved by. And I think it needs to be seen at least for what Linklater has done with, you know, I think it was massive and ambitious and overall a very good movie.
Yeah.
I definitely agree. Just to touch back with the Before Sunrise, Sunset, that no hold thing, I think it sort of is a culmination of sort of those experiments and even works better than those three films, which got a little bit, what's the word I'm looking for? It was not so mundane. It took more interesting pieces of the life very specifically.
Yeah.
It still felt like a day in the life, but it focused on very specific moments, whereas those other three films at times could feel just a little bit overdrawn and there's no reason this needs to be on screen.
Like, we're just going for a walk to the grocery store.
Yeah, right, definitely. Yep. All right, guys. Well, obviously, one, I appreciate you both coming on so we can just talk shop and chop it up on these different films. But obviously this weekend, you know, we had the daunting task of starting to vote. I don't know how you guys felt, but it was difficult.
Yeah.
How did the voting situation go for you guys? I mean, I know I was up like last minute. I had like all of my screeners laid out, like all my reviews from the year, the notes, and I was just like, what do I do?
I know there were a few times where I thought I had filled in the whole category, and then like, how did I miss that person for best actor?
Right.
It's like, how did I just, that slipped my mind and have to go back and redo everything there.
Right, exactly.
I felt like I was more, you know, I was prepared this year. I felt like I had, you know, I'd started organizing my thoughts and my nominations early in the week, and, you know, sure enough, you get these things just rolling in the mail, and then all of a sudden I'm disorganized, and then the next thing you know, it's nomination time, and I've got all these lists that haven't been pared down enough, and it's tough. It's hard. It's harder than it seems until you do it. You know, have all these possibilities.
Right.
Feel a little brain dead.
Definitely. All right, guys. So for those that are watching the show, how can they reach you and read your reviews? Mike, let's start with you.
DCfilmdom.com, www.dcfilmdom.com. Myself and Eddie Pasa write for and around the site. Also on Facebook, look for DC Filmdom on Facebook and look for us on Twitter.
Awesome.
Yep. You can find my reviews and other articles on filmhamster.com, and you can also find me on Facebook and Twitter.
Cool. Well, guys, again, thanks so much for coming on the show. Always
thank
a pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Yep. Thank you.
All right. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Anthony Anderson. I'm the writer, producer, director of Anacostia, the web series, and you're watching Picture Lock.
That's all for this episode. I'd like to thank my fellow critics for coming on the show and talking film with me. Make sure you check out their reviews at dcfilmdom.com and filmhamster.com. You can find Picture Lock on Facebook and Twitter. Don't forget to check out the website picturelockshow.com for movie reviews, news, and if you're interested in being a guest on the show. Be sure to subscribe to the mailing list on the site as well so that you can win free passes to upcoming screenings in the DMV area. Until next time, I hope you stay locked on film.